Good morning.
Good morning.
I don't think this mic is working.
Yes.
Oh, it is. Okay. I couldn't hear it myself. Well, it's good to see everyone again this morning on this, the sixth Sunday of Easter. So we begin with the singing of our opening hymn, number 556. Invite the congregation to stand, turning page 151 of our hymnal. In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
If we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves, and the truth is not in us.
But if we confess our sins, God, who is faithful and just, will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness.
Let us then confess our sins to God our Father. Most merciful God,
we confess that we are by nature sinful and unclean. We have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We justly deserve your present and eternal punishment. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us. Forgive us, renew us, and lead us, so that we can live right in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your holy name. Amen.
Almighty God, in his mercy, has given his Son to die for you, and for his sake forgives you all your sins, as a called and ordained servant of Christ and by his authority. I therefore forgive you all your sins in the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
Let us pray to the Lord for the peace from above and for our salvation. Let us pray to the Lord. For the peace of the whole world, for the well-being of the Church of God, and for the unity of all, let us pray to the Lord. For this holy house and for all who offer here their worship and praise, let us pray to the Lord. Help, save, comfort, and defend us, gracious Lord.
Thank you.
be with you. Let us pray. O God, the giver of all that is good, by your holy inspiration, grant that we may think those things that are right, and by your merciful guiding, accomplish them. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Please be seated. The first of our readings taken from the book of the Acts of the Apostles, the 16th chapter, beginning at the 9th verse. A vision appeared to Paul in the night. A man from Macedonia was standing there, urging him and saying, "Come over to Macedonia and help us." And when Paul had seen the vision, immediately we sought to go on to Macedonia, concluding that God had called us to preach the gospel to them. So setting sail for Troas, we made a direct voyage to Samothrace, and the following day to Neapolis, and from there to Philippi, which is a leading city of the district of Macedonia and a Roman colony. We remained in this city some days, and on the Sabbath day, we went outside the gate to the riverside, where we supposed there was a place of prayer, and we sat down and spoke to the women who had come together. One who heard us was a woman named Lydia, from the city of Thyatira, a seller of purple goods, who was a worshiper of God. The Lord opened her heart to pay attention to what was said by Paul. And after she was baptized, and her household as well, she urged us, saying, "If you have judged me to be faithful to the Lord, come to my house and stay." And she prevailed upon us. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. The epistle from the book of the Apocalypse, also called Revelation, the 21st chapter. Then came one of the seven angels who had the seven bowls full of the seven last plagues and spoke to me, saying, "Come, I will show you the bride, the wife of the Lamb." And he carried me away in the spirit to a great high mountain and showed me the holy city Jerusalem coming down out of heaven from God, having the glory of God. Its radiance like a most rare jewel, like a jasper, clear as crystal. It had a great high wall with 12 gates, and at the gates 12 angels, and on the gates the names of the 12 tribes of the sons of Israel were inscribed. On the east gate, three gates. On the east, three gates, and on the north, three gates. On the south, three gates, and on the west, three gates. And the wall of the city had 12 foundations, and on them were 12 names of the 12 apostles of the Lamb. And the 12 gates were 12 pearls, each of the gates made of a single pearl, and the street of the city was pure gold, transparent as glass. And I saw no temple in the city, for its temple is the Lord God, the Almighty, and the Lamb. And the city has no need of sun or moon to shine on it, for the glory of God gives it light, and its lamp is the Lamb. By its light will the nations walk, and the kings of the earth will bring their glory into it. And its gates will never be shut by day, and there will be no night there. They will bring into it the glory and the honor of the nations. But nothing unclean will ever enter it, nor anyone who does what is detestable or false, but only those who are written in the Lamb's Book of Life. This is the word of the Lord.
Thanks be to God.
Please stand for the singing of the Alleluia. The Holy Gospel according to St. John, the 16th chapter. In that day, you will ask nothing of me. Truly, truly, I say to you, whatever you ask of the Father in my name, he will give it to you. Until now, you have asked nothing in my name. Ask, and you will receive, that your joy may be full. I have said these things to you in figures of speech. The hour is coming when I will no longer speak to you in figures of speech, but will tell you plainly about the Father. In that day you will ask in my name, and I do not say to you that I will ask the Father on your behalf, for the Father himself loves you, because you have loved me and have believed that I came from God. I came from the Father and have come into the world, and now I am leaving the world and going to the Father. His disciples said, "Ah, now you're speaking plainly and not using figurative speech. Now we know that you know all things and do not need anyone to question you. This is why we believe that you came from God." Jesus answered them, "Do you now believe? Behold, the hour is coming. Indeed, it has come when you will be scattered, each to his own home, and will leave me alone. Yet I'm not alone, for the Father is with me. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. In the world you will have tribulation, but take heart, I have overcome the world." This is the gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, O Christ.
Please be seated as we continue the singing of our hymn, number 556, stanzas 6 through 10. Bow our heads in word of prayer. Gracious and eternal God and Father, We give thanks to you for the blessed opportunity you provide to your people this day as we gather in worship and praise. We sing your praise, we adore your name forever. Grant today this, O Father, that the words of my lips and meditation within our hearts might be found worthy and acceptable in your most holy and gracious sight. Yes, hear our prayer, Father, for the sake of Jesus, your Son, our Savior, and Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit as the one eternal, the triune God. Amen. Fifty-one years ago this year, Coca-Cola Company gathered a vast number of young people and moved them into Italy onto a mountaintop, spread them out, and had them to sing a song together from all different nationalities. You may remember it if you're old enough. Most of you can't because you're far too young for this. But I want you to pay attention to these lyrics, at least some of these lyrics, that I'm going to read to you. I'd like to teach the world to sing in perfect harmony. I'd like to hold it in my arms and keep it company. A noble thought, to be sure. Calm, tranquility, peace. Well, this was during the Vietnam era. Young men, young women were losing their lives on the battlefield. Sorrow. Riots took place to such an extent that our president was called upon the National Guard to suppress those riots. Further, violence broke out for a variety of different reasons. The stock market was plummeting on a downhill fall. And the leading causes of death were stroke or heart disease. Then entered the song. And so many people wished if only it could be true. If only there could be peace and harmony. If only there could be a time where there was no pain, no suffering, that we could, as it were, hold the world in our arms and keep it company. But such was not to be the case, was it? Far from it. But I need to ask this question, what about today? Only recently, flags hung at half staff. For a very basic reason. Over 1 million of our citizens have died from COVID. And sorrow permeates our society. War rages on, not in Vietnam, but in Ukraine. Many of our Christian brothers and sisters have lost their lives or have been displaced by an invading army. Students in a middle school have now chosen to ignore their teachers, who basically are seen as gangs in the hallways, beating each other up, and will not listen to any authority, no matter what it is. Murder takes place on such a regular basis, whether it's in the Quad Cities or maybe here even in Galesburg or elsewhere. That doesn't faze us any longer, does it? We don't even think too much about it. Oh, someone else was shot. Someone else was killed. That lackadaisical type attitude permeates our society. Today, we see the stock market on a topsy-turvy type attitude. Some cheer as we await the outcome of the decision by the Supreme Court on the law of Mississippi and whether or not Roe v. Wade will be overturned. Some cheer. Some
are thrilled by what may take place. Meanwhile, others jeer in protest against what they offer is hatred against women, denying the fact that they hate children. Perhaps those knowing that song of 51 years ago wish it would become a present-day reality. But as sin continues to manifest itself in our society today, to dominate, ever since the time of Adam and Eve fall into sin, those lyrics will remain incomplete, unfinished, never taking place. So what's a Christian to do? How's a Christian to respond? How are we to live as Christians in a society like this? A society that is so fragmented. A world that is so sinful. How can we live when Christian principles are ignored or totally rejected? In answer, let's look at what our gospel reading for today says. And what did Jesus have to say to those early disciples? Did he promise them a bed of roses? Did he promise to them that everything was going to be fine? Did he say to them that everything would be just as they wished it to be, a time of peace and tranquility? Far from it. What did he say? What did he talk about? He talked about a fragmented world, even in their era. Being one of his disciples, being, as the people would call them, one of this man's disciples, they would be marked as enemies, enemies of the state, enemies of others, all because they dared to believe in Jesus Christ as Lord and Savior. Being a disciple would not be easy. They would be scattered, for soon their master, the rabbi, Jesus of Nazareth, would be betrayed. Taken and condemned to death. Taken outside the city of Jerusalem and placed upon a cross, nailed to it, his hands and his feet. They would be scattered, running for their very lives, terrified of what would happen to them. Remember his words, what he had previously spoken to them. In a little while, and you will not see me. And again a little while, and you will see me. The future Jesus was speaking to them about and offering to them seemed rather bleak, didn't it? It seemed very odious. Downright of a stench. They'd be isolated. They'd be all alone. He wouldn't be with them. They could not imagine what that would be like to be amidst the threats and rejection and the loneliness that they would soon experience without his presence. In only a few brief hours from the time of our reading, Jesus would be betrayed. He would be taken by force. He'd be ordered to stand trial, both by the religious authorities as well as by the authorities of the state. The Romans. He'd be condemned and then sentenced to death by crucifixion. It would be then at that time that the disciples would really be in a state of turmoil, a state of doom and gloom. What next? They were forced to now live in a world that was bent on its own destruction, a world where there could be no peace. A world there could be that could only reject the message of Jesus and him crucified for the forgiveness of sins. So what were they to do? But to this uncertainty, to this time, Jesus reassures them. But take heart, for I have overcome the world. Jesus did not in any way say it was going to be easy,
But he said he has already overcome the world.
He had, though not yet completed his passion, his suffering, his death, his rising from the tomb, though that was not yet completed, already he tells them, but I have overcome the world. Yes, soon he would finish his task. Soon he would complete the action given to him by the Father. Soon he would die. Soon he would rise. Soon he would ascend because of his function, his purpose to save his people from their sins. Since Christ has overcome the world that does not know him, the disciples have been given the responsibility of going to that world with confident hope, with confident joy, with power from on high. Still, the question I pose to us today is this: do we always feel confident about our future in this world? Or do we feel less confidence in what the future holds for us? There is one of the old sketches of the cartoon of Calvin and Hobbes, which goes back many years, where the two come marching into the living room early one morning, and Calvin's mother is seated there in her chair, drinking her morning cup of coffee. She suddenly looks up and she sees young Calvin. He has a large space helmet on his head and a long flowing cape coming down behind him, dragging on the floor. One hand, he's holding a flashlight. And on the other hand, he's holding a ball bat. What's that all about? She asked. Well, you never know. You never know what? She asked. You never know. Something could happen today. Then Calvin marches off. If anything does, by golly, I'm going to be ready for it. Calvin's mother looks out at the reading audience and says, I think I need a suit like that too. How many of us really feel confident? Confident in a world that is so filled with turmoil? How many of us feel confident? Or do we feel like scared rabbits, not knowing what to know, do, how to act, how to live? Where can a Christian receive hope in a seemingly hopeless situation, a hopeless society? Well, let's remember what Jesus said to us. I have said these things to you, that in me you may have peace. Here we are only 5 Sundays after Easter. We call this the 6th Sunday of Easter. But nonetheless, we recall those words of Jesus as he enters into that room, that upper room, where he had given them the meal, and where, as he enters that room that's locked, where the disciples are meeting, and he says to them, peace be with you. My peace I give to you. Not as the world gives do I give to you. Peace be with you. Not the peace of this world, not the peace that you can buy at a local store, but peace that comes alone in knowing Jesus as Savior and Lord. That is the peace that he offers you today. He offers it to me today. He offers it to us every day. Because this peace, this world doesn't understand. The peace that came down from heaven, bringing peace between God and man. The cross is always the sign of peace. That God waged war against himself, as it were, having his own son die upon the cross for the sin of us all to ensure peace for us. Peace with his cross. Peace as he rose from the 3-day tomb. Peace so that we might go to the place that he has prepared for us, that he will come again for us, that we might be taken to be with him, that where he is, we might live forever. Yes, we need to have some real comfort given to us. And Jesus is that comfort. Jesus is the one that comes to you and to me today. He comes to us through the Word. He comes to us through the sacrament. He comes to us. Don't you see? To offer us peace. Peace that he alone gives, not as the world gives. That you might have peace. I have overcome the world, he told us. But the further our faith falters, we demonstrate how we often forget those words of Jesus, of comfort. Because we remember him saying, now I'm leaving the world and going to the Father. So what should Christians do? As we see this world coming unglued, as this world seems so coming unglued, so ripe for destruction, mourn, sorrow, get so depressed, have confidence. Pray. It's confident hope. Jesus told his disciples, ask the Father in my name, believing it will be done. That's confident hope. Not wish. It's confidence. Confidence not in self, not in this world, but in the Christ of God. We can carry that hope with us wherever we go, whether it is in our home, whether it is where we go to our work, wherever we go in this life, we carry that confidence because it is the Christ who brings us that confidence. Pray in his name is what he has told us. Ask and you will receive and your joy will be made complete. Now we have complete access to the Father. We can pray to the Father, knowing he hears it and answers it for Jesus' sake. Driving through my village, I often see a car with a license. And what it says on that license really strikes home. It's a word, one word only. And the word is courage. I don't know the background, how the word came about upon that license plate. All I know is I've seen that so often. It's made me think that that's what Christians are being told to have, courage. Courage not in self, but courage in Christ. Courage in knowing of what he's done for us. Courage of knowing that he's going to prepare a place for us, even as we prepare to celebrate Ascension on Thursday of this week. Courage that he gives to us as he ensures us through his own body and blood under the simple foods of bread and wine. Courage, a courageous hope in him. Though many may have a most pessimistic outlook on this world and the problems that we face day by day, the adverse conditions, the escalating cost of fuel and the cost of living ever increasing, we have what the Apostle Peter reminds us, lively hope, a lively hope that is in the confidence in knowing Jesus Christ, as we say, my Lord and my Savior. We have that lively hope that is Christ Jesus, our Lord, so that it is with that confidence that we declare this, as we said it on Easter Sunday morning, Christ is risen! He is risen indeed! Hallelujah. Amen. And the peace of God which surpasses all understanding. Now keep your hearts and your minds to the knowledge and the faith that is in Christ Jesus, he who is our Lord, our Savior. Amen. I invite the congregation to stand, for the creed is found on page 158. We confess the faith together. I believe in one God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and of all things visible and invisible, and in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only begotten Son of God,
begotten of his Father before all worlds, God of God, light of light, very God of very God, begotten, not made, being of one substance with the Father, by whom all things were made, who for us men and for our salvation came down from heaven, and was incarnate by the Holy Spirit of the Virgin Mary, and was made man, and was crucified also for us under Pontius Pilate. He suffered and was buried. And the third day he rose again according to the Scriptures, and ascended into heaven, and sits at the right hand of the Father. And he will come again with glory to judge both the living and the dead, whose kingdom will end. And I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Spirit of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son, who with the Father and the Son together is worshipped and glorified, who spoke by the prophets. And I believe in one holy Christian apostolic church. I acknowledge one baptism for the remission of sins, and I look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen. In our prayers today, we especially remember the family of Jim Bloomberg, who was killed in a farming accident this past Thursday. Lord, our Heavenly Father, you never refuse the cries of your children. In the name of our Lord Jesus, we ask for your help and protection for the good of our families, our neighbors and our rulers, our brothers and sisters in Christ, our pastors and our overseers. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Lord God, you have founded your church as a place of prayer beside the waters of holy baptism. Give your holy people hearts to hear your gospel message, lips to offer their prayers in faith, and readiness to give of themselves for your sake. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Heavenly Father, keep your holy church undefiled from all that is detestable or false. Embolden pastors to guard her gates and to welcome those who draw near in faith. Bring the rulers of this world into your church to glorify her according to your good and gracious will. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Give peace, Lord, to our families, to our homes, and enliven them with Christ's resurrected life. Let the forgiveness of sins reign among husbands and wives, parents and children. Assure those who live alone that they too are your children, upheld by your right hand. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Gracious God, give wisdom to our leaders and government, that they may lead with integrity and
according to your perfect will.
Protect
police officers, emergency personnel, disaster relief workers, and the members of our armed forces as they serve in our defense and for the well-being of all. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Compassionate Lord,
direct and enrich the efforts of the faithful women of your church. Make them eager and wise in good works, serving the ministry of the church as faithful Lydia served the mission of St. Paul. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Merciful God, you hear our
prayers for the sake of your own dear Son, Jesus. In his name we cast our burdens upon you. Especially remember Brittany Kane. We also remember the family of Jim Bloomberg. O gracious Lord, strengthen them and encourage them. Sustain them in the midst of terror and trial. And hear them as they cry out for your Son. Lord, in your mercy, Heavenly Father, give repentance and faith to all who receive your Lord's body and blood, our Lord's body and blood today, that in this unity of a true confession, they may receive it for the forgiveness of their sins. Lord, in your mercy,
hear our prayer.
Into your hands, O Lord, we commend all for whom we pray, trusting in your mercy through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen.
Congregation will be seated as the ushers come forward receiving the gifts of God's people. The Lord be with you. Lift up your hearts. Let us give thanks to the Lord our God. Truly good, right, and salutary that we should at all times and in all places give thanks to you, Holy Lord, Almighty Father, everlasting God. And most especially are we bound to praise you on this day for the glorious resurrection of your Son, Jesus Christ, the very Paschal Lamb, who was sacrificed for us and bore the sins of the world. By his dying, he has destroyed death, and by his rising again, he has restored to us everlasting life. Therefore, with Mary Magdalene, Peter, and John, and with all the witnesses of the resurrection, with angels and archangels, and with all the company of heaven, we laud and magnify your glorious name evermore, praising you and saying, Blessed are you, Lord of heaven and earth, for you have had mercy on those whom you created and sent your only begotten Son into our flesh to bear our sin and be our Savior. With repentant joy, we receive the salvation accomplished for us by the all-availing sacrifice of his body and his blood on the cross. Gathered in the name and the remembrance of Jesus, we beg you, O Lord, to forgive, renew, and strengthen us with your word and spirit. Grant us faithfully to eat his body and drink his blood as he bids us do in his own testament. Gather us together, we pray, from the ends of the earth to celebrate with all the faithful the marriage feast of the Lamb in his kingdom, which has no end. Graciously receive our prayers. Deliver and preserve us. To you alone, O Father, be all glory, honor, and worship with the Son and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. Lord, remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray, our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Our Lord Jesus Christ, on the night in which he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and gave it to them, saying, take, eat, this is my body, which is given for you. This do in remembrance of me. In the same manner also, he took the cup after supper, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, take, drink of it, all of you. This cup is the New Testament in my blood, which is shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. This do as often as you drink it in remembrance of me. The peace of the Lord be with you always. Amen. body and blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, strengthen, preserve, and keep you steadfast to life eternal. Peace be with you. Amen. Welcome to the table of the Lord. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. The Almighty God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Take and eat. This is the true body of your Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. He was given to death for the remission of all sin. Christ, given and created for the remission of all sin. You can eat the true body of Christ. Take and drink the precious blood of Christ shed for you. The blood of the Lord Jesus Christ given and shed for you for the remission of sins. And now may this accrue by and true blood of your Lord and Savior Jesus the Christ strengthen, preserve, and keep you steadfast until the day of life eternal. Go in the peace of the Christ. Rejoice, your sins forgiven by him. Amen. Thank you. Let us pray. We give thanks to you, Almighty God, that you have refreshed us through this salutary gift. And we implore you that of your mercy, you would strengthen us through the same in faith and love towards one another. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine on you and be gracious to you.
The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give to you
peace. Any announcements? Wonderful. Must be a first. May the Lord give you a gracious week in his sight. It's again pleasant to be with you, share with you God's holy word. Go in peace.